First of all, thank you all for being here for this kind of opening event for Loop, and thank you to Loop and all the organizers for making possible year after year this particular event, which brings over like so many people interested in audiovisual production and video more specifically. And we're here to actually share thoughts on issues around video collections and all the paradoxes that stem out of this particular form of collection. For that purpose, I mean, we invited Helena Fernandino and Emilio P. They are collectors, and their collection holds like almost 1,000 titles, which span the entire history of the media. Some of those works can be watched downstairs, and you'll find works by Jenny Holzer, Marcel Odenbach, Rosemary Trockel, Jürgen Klauke, Bruce Neumann. And I would like to remark, to stress the idea that this is the one collection that actually reveals the evolution of video as a medium since the late 60s, namely the work of Bruce Neumann, up until recently. And when we exhibited Video Regime in Madrid with a larger selection of works, we actually included many works from what they like to call the archive part of their collection. So video collections raise like many interesting issues, and some of those are not easy to tackle. That's why, I mean, we thought that it would be kind of worth to spend a few minutes discussing those contradictions. Let's begin by addressing the idea that the accumulation of video does not necessarily create a collection, but it might well create an archive, a bunch of works. Or let's discuss a little bit, I mean, what should be the most suitable category for the accumulation of video works? Because so far you have already experienced the problem of managing such a vast number of works. Estaba diciendo que sería interesante discutir, es decir, ¿cómo podríamos nombrar ese conjunto patrimonial que habéis acumulado a lo largo de unos años? Y que en muchos casos se parece más a un archivo que no a una colección tradicional. De hasta even some of their most recent acquisitions are acquisitions that are not actually possessed in traditional terms as an object, but which stay in a cloud, or you can download, you know, eventually, and you get like, you know, limited right to watch the piece. So they are very, very good representatives of this particular form of collection, that it's traversed different forms of objectuality and property. So, Emilio, ¿prefieres empezar tú?
Simplemente porque lo has planteado muy bien, y sí tendríamos que decir que la, digamos, la evolución de la colección ha sido justamente inversa. Y nosotros empezamos a coleccionar y empezamos a comprar vídeo muy contemporáneo. Pero justamente una de las virtualidades que tiene este tipo de piezas es que enseguida tira un poco la historia. Y lo que hicimos es, para entender mejor lo que estábamos comprando y lo que estábamos disfrutando, lo que estábamos viendo, tuvimos que echar marcha atrás y ver piezas más antiguas que de algún modo completaban perfectamente el lenguaje, la historia de las piezas de los artistas, digamos, más contemporáneos. Por lo tanto, casi empezamos muy contemporáneo y estamos completando casi con piezas clásicas.
Yes, but I think the most important has been said. Anyway, to have the first, but the history of video is not from the 60s, is the prehistory of video, 60s. For us was the way to give a baseline to the collection. So we have contemporary videos, but how he said, we could better understand the contemporary pieces and getting the prehistoric video pieces from the 60s, no? Is a way to give a sense to the collection. I'm not totally agree when people say this one historical collection or one archive collection. I think it's we try to find the sense of the collection. But it's not a question of archiving or
right.
Okay.
Right. Well, it is true that video collections create like very personal ways of accumulation, like collectors like Teresa Sapé, also in Madrid, who is an architect, she envisions her collection as a sum of big video installations that if she ever manages to put them together, it will really look like the biggest of the museums one can imagine. So, but when you visit her collection can be watched in a monitor and it's condensated in a hard drive. So this is one of the particularities of video. I mean, it can be both extremely compressed and it can be also sort of, you know, fully blown, presented, enlarged, projected into spaces as to recreate like a traditional and conventional museum or gallery-like space. How do you deal with your collection, given that you are one of the few collectors who can actually presume that you have actually accumulated like a large number of works?
We have 14 screens at home. When there is no video running, it seems a shop, a TV shop. And, but anyway, when people come, we change. We have curated our own exhibition, particular exhibition, individual exhibition for
but
friends.
You have curated it in your own house. In our house.
Yes. Yes, we have. We learn little by little, little. Well, and we have installation too. But it's true that we have some installation that we have bought and we never see after, because right. They take many, many place. So one aim for us is to share this collection, and. People and institution borrow some pieces and we can see it.
¿Quieres decir algo, Emilio?
Sí, respecto a... Realmente hemos comprado mucho y nos rodeamos de piezas y de vídeos que podamos, como bien dice Helena, disfrutar, visionar. Y luego a la vista de la colección, efectivamente, igual queda un poco cojo en lo que llamamos instalaciones. Y posiblemente la primera razón, hay dos razones. Una, que efectivamente queríamos tener cosas que las disfrutar y no dejarlas en un almacén y posiblemente no visionarlas nunca. Y por otro lugar, también es un formato de colección, como diría yo, digamos, pensamos que esas grandes piezas tienen que estar en instituciones. O sea, esto es una colección personal, doméstica, de los dos, y que en ningún caso quiere, digamos, emular o suplantar ese otro tipo de planteamientos mucho más ambiciosos. Uh-huh. Y por lo tanto, prácticamente pues el 80% de las piezas que tenemos las podemos disfrutar en casa.
Sí, de hecho, muchos de los trabajos, de las obras que tenéis son vídeos monocanal. Diría que un poco es la cultura de un cinéfilo que de repente ha descubierto el vídeo, ¿no? Como una producción subsidiaria de la historia del cine. Yo creo que por eso os habéis sentido, digamos, atraídos por la idea de recrear una historia que a pesar de breve hemos visto que ya ha atravesado diferentes formatos, desde los vídeos de finales de los 60 hasta, como decía, esas obras que permanecen en la nube, ¿no? Y que descargáis casi como, bueno, pues eso, on demand, ¿no? It looks like your collection might be also compared to a, like a library. You know, I mean, so video has also created the possibility to concentrate the collection in private spaces. I mean, that's kind of a common common sort of condition, or it's kind of recurring in most of those private collections devoted to video. Most people collect video because they can have it at home and they don't need to actually spend lots of money in storage space, restoration, maintenance, preservation, etc., etc. So it really demands a much more kind of low-key logistics. Yeah? Yeah.
It's one anthropological video collection.
Well, yeah, you can say that.
In a way. But I don't know when we understand that it's a library, video library or archive, but it's not the sense we... I think of all that, I keep the sense of research. More than, because archive or library for me sometimes is something is dead, you know. No, I think research is important in this collection.
Justamente yo creo que una de las grandes ventajas o virtualidades que tiene estos formatos es que, insisto, que permite completar con piezas. Voy a ser más directo. Es decir, una de las características del vídeo tiene que ver con la forma de exhibir los derechos de exhibición. Entonces, las colecciones están basadas, y su corpus fundamental, tienen que ser piezas, vídeos, con derechos de exhibición pública, sea instalaciones o sea videocanal. Pero hay otra forma de completar las colecciones, que es un poco lo que tú comentabas, Carles, que viene a ser como una especie de archivo, en el cual puedes tener muchas otras piezas que son de exhibición en Estados Unidos y en Canadá, y en el mundo anglosajón funciona muchísimo, que son piezas de exhibición en aula, que son piezas de exhibición educacional, y que permite entender mucho mejor las colecciones. Por lo tanto, nosotros no solamente hacemos la colección, digamos, clásica o convencional de piezas compradas en galerías y de ediciones cortas o originales, también creemos que para entender bien la colección hace falta ese otro tipo de piezas. Por lo tanto, en ese sentido, sí coincido contigo en que hay una parte, digamos, de archivo que complementa la parte, digamos, de la colección convencional.
Pero en muchos casos los vídeos que vosotros habéis coleccionado son vídeos asociados a autores, a la producción de una figura que es el artista y que le da esa calidad, digamos, de un trabajo singular, único, original. ¿Alguna vez os habéis sentido tentados por la posibilidad de coleccionar una producción en vídeo, audiovisual, que no tenga autores? Me refiero a coleccionar vídeos. Hay que recordar que, por ejemplo, Bill Viola inicia su carrera no como un artista, digamos, autor independiente, sino como alguien asociado a la Guerrilla Television, a una utilización del vídeo como instrumento comunitario. En vuestro deseo de reconstruir todas esas modalidades del vídeo, ¿habéis alguna vez pensado en también adquirir ese tipo de producción?
Lo has explicado muy bien. En este momento, igual que el vídeo se inicia con una vocación casi social de retransmisión por televisiones en canal y se entendía como una forma de comunicación distinta y hasta un punto, digamos, como revulsivo, ahora se está produciendo exactamente lo mismo, pero a través de Internet. Hay dos comentarios. Uno, es algo que están haciendo, que sin lugar a dudas va a tener una dimensión que desconocemos, y creo que alguien tendrá que hacer, posiblemente alguna institución o algún coleccionista privado, poner el foco en ese tipo de piezas y que esa volatilidad que tienen en este momento, estar en la nube, no se pierda. Pero yo creo que nosotros ya tenemos bastante con lo que tenemos.
Here comes a tricky question. I mean, how do you feel when you actually purchase, acquire an important work, and then you see that exactly the same work can be, or it's circulating through internet, and it's accessible to a great majority of people for nothing, just open access? So, I mean, does it create a paradox, a contradiction in your understanding?
I don't think so. No, no, it doesn't matter. I think one aim for us is to share the collections of if other people or other artists put the pieces in big circuits, mm-hmm. I think we'll have not any problem.
But then, I mean, that money.
But the property, yes, that money, and we are not rich, so it's possible to collect and not without being rich, huh? Mm-hmm. And without, okay, it's a question of priorities. So. For us, it was a priority, and sorry, what was the question?
I was going to ask, I mean, how do you actually conceptualize that investment? I mean, do you think that you acquired a property, or you just share the cost of production, you supported production? I mean, how do you conceptualize, I mean, that money spent in the acquisition of a work?
At the moment, everything was pleasure, okay, till now. I think now we have to start to focus in another aspect of one collection, because it's it's big and fun, big. Mm? There is bigger ones, but for
it's
domestic collection is yes.
Yeah.
And we start now to. People think to collect is only to buy and to see and to watch and to show, okay? But the collection have many, many other aspects.
Indeed.
That's the catalog, the conservation, and now, I don't know, but the question of our property for us is important only in certain way. We haven't started as an investment.
Yeah.
We never thought about investment. Yeah? Our car has 15 years, and for us it's not a problem.
Mm-hmm.
For us it's not a problem. One day the car will
break.
Break and we will change. Huh? But one thing is, yeah, I think at the moment we are thinking about if this collection could be the basement for another project, relate to art too. But we are thinking about.
Okay.
So at the moment it's over
there. I was actually going to ask, I mean, if this is heritage, I mean, if considering the amount of work you have accumulated, if this is considered heritage, what sort of transmission does this heritage require? I mean, how can you bequeath these sort of properties, assets? I mean, what is it to be transmitted when you have acquired that kind of collection?
Mm-hmm.
What is it that you're going to give or leave for the future?
For the future, we're thinking about. But as I told you, we are thinking that the collection must be the ¿cómo se dice? El motor, the engine.
The engine
to start another project.
Mm-hmm.
But it's now we are thinking about. Okay.
Emilio, ¿cómo editorializarías tu colección? Es decir, ¿qué idea motora ha tenido hasta ahora esa colección? Es decir, hay muchas colecciones, cuando entrevistamos a Estefanía Meana, que es lo que denominamos una coleccionista de segunda generación, second generation collector, Estefanía Meana, she actually stressed the idea that she liked to collect works that express some kind of social concern, and then she only buys works that she can actually see a very personal political interest reflected on the work, namely, for example, the work of Willie Doherty or authors like that. So, en vuestro caso, es decir, ¿cuál es el concepto editorial detrás de la colección?
Well,
no hay un concepto rector. Casi después de tanto tiempo y a la vista de la colección, casi se hace una línea editorial por exclusión. Es decir, posiblemente no tengamos vídeos bonitos, vídeos bellos que los ves y resulten agradables. Tenemos muy pocas piezas que contengan diálogos, por ejemplo. No es que busquemos vídeos en los cuales no existe el diálogo y que la imagen lo diga todo, pero a veces resulta de esta manera. Hemos tenido, o sea, nos interesa más piezas, algunas que tienen que ver con la documentación o la performance, piezas con contenido social, piezas que de algún modo utilicen también la imagen de una manera sugerente, y todo aquello que de alguna manera con otros formatos, ya sea la pintura, ya sea la fotografía, es difícil de expresar. Y sin embargo, con la imagen en movimiento, si se consigue, o si consigue el artista explicar o exponer o emocionar de alguna manera.
Indeed, I mean, this is a collection that where you can find works that, let's put it this way, they are no longer in fashion. I mean, if you look downstairs, there is a row of 5 video works from their collection, including Eugenio Didborn, Marcel Odenbach, Jenny Holzer, Jürgen Klauke, Rosemary Trockel, even going back to Bruce Nauman, which are works produced in the late 70s, early 80s, narrative, experimental, and let's say they go against the grain of the pictorial turn, which has been so much predominant in contemporary recent video production. Some cases, because I mean, video is going through a similar process as photography went through in the 90s, when photography aim at looking like paintings, you know, and acquiring the same value as paintings had as a sort of, you know, solid value. So video is in some ways, you know, suffering or going through a similar process, trying to echo, you know, the value of a real painting, which represents kind of the main assets in the art maker. But their collection goes or runs against the grain of this year, you know, and as you can see, the videos are really, really kind of off track this year. So, I mean, see, Helena?
Sorry, you have choose for the exhibition videos that relating what you are saying now, but we have many different videos. But what is curious with video is that now we see short videos in the films. When we see a film, we say, "Tiens, this is a video. From here to here is a video piece."
That would make a nice piece.
So it's a curious evolution. But yes, really, we come from a ver. Es que he olvidado. El cine de... our culture from 16, when yeah, we were 16 years old,
film amateurs,
come from a film amateurs film
right,
studio.
Okay.
Film. I we remember we have seen Akira Kurosawa's that you 5 hours, I think, when I was 15 years with my father. And was, for me, medieval Japan. Was very curious, and we have many centers of video of films, the arte ensayo, how
yeah,
you say, arte ensayo,
as a film,
as a film when we were young. So we have this kind of culture.
That's a nice idea, since you cannot buy like a feature length film, so you buy like a bit of it, you know, like a chunk of it. Great. I don't know, maybe it's time to open the floor to your questions and comments, and we will be glad, they will be glad to respond to your questions as well. We can pass around the mic.
I always say one collection is not so important for the number of works, the value, but for the value. No? We are not speaking about numbers, but about value. Mm. Anyway, he told at the beginning that we have with the archives and original pieces and installation and short edition, we have more or less 1,000. But number is nothing.
And they are all worth watching, indeed.
More comments, questions?
Yes.
I suppose, you know, when you have by now a collection which is quite extensive, you said it's 1,000 pieces that you have. When you look now at videos that you might want to purchase, do you think that process now must be quite different to what it was when you first started?
Yes, we continue the research. I mean, at the beginning, we buy pieces that we like it, okay? And now we are completing, not completing, because I think a collection is never completed, but giving a sense, and we have to building up a pedagogical area. I mean, if we want to share our collection, we would like to share as we thought about it. So if is the research, we think is good to have a pedagogical area in the inside the collection. Okay.
No me ha quedado muy claro la diferencia entre colección y archivo o biblioteca. No sé si esto tiene que ver con el concepto artístico o tiene que ver con el precio de las cosas, etc. I am asking them that I cannot make a difference, or I actually don't understand the difference, which they seem to have made a distinct difference between an archive and a collection. And a library, so I don't know if this is a format, but let her answer.
I think if we go to the, for instance, as a metaphor, the pictures you have here, okay? Perhaps you have not the space to exhibit all the pictures that the club has. If you have it in a room, the question is, do you start to ask that the cave? You know what I mean? When we say archive, is the reason why for me it's quite curious to speak about archive. ¿Sabes qué quiero decir? Sí. Es como si dices, el que tiene cuadros y los tiene en un almacén, no hablas de la colección, hablas de almacén.
I think that the archive refers to the very possibility of compressing the whole collection.
The content and the container.
Exactly. Maybe Emilio.
Sí, hay una diferencia también que tiene que ver justamente con el propio formato del vídeo. Es decir, cuando nosotros estamos hablando de vídeos históricos, vídeos en Collection Pi, son vídeos que nunca estuvieron en el mercado, nunca se vendieron, pero sí se han conservado. Y esos vídeos están fuera del mercado de alguna manera, no se venden en las galerías, pero se pueden adquirir. Y en algunos casos tienen, otra de las características de estos formatos, son los derechos de exhibición. Los puedes comprar con derechos de exhibición. Eso permite completar la colección, pero no son vídeos que compras directamente en una galería comercial porque ya no existen. Pero, sin embargo, sí se han conservado y hay instituciones que se han dedicado a conservar, a restaurar esas piezas, que, por lo tanto, también se pueden adquirir. Esa sería un poco la diferencia entre lo que es el archivo a lo que son las piezas, digamos convencionales que compras en una galería en una edición de 5 o de 3. Esa es la diferencia.
Y es la pata pedagógica también, porque permite recorrer la historia del vídeo a través de piezas que no están en circulación.
What do you want to transmit with your collection?
Good question. Good. I don't know really. When we start to make it, we didn't think about it. We think about pleasure first. Take pleasure and give pleasure, because we share it. This was the beginning. And now, I don't know, we are not so strong to make a foundation or think like that, or nice containers with architect films and everything. I don't know, transmit for us, I think, is the video that transmit to her something.
You speak about pedagogy.
Pedagogy, yes, because is we are with people, and if one day, I don't know what we are doing with this collection at the moment, and but I think it is important if some other people is going to see it, has the possibility to find the way from the beginning of the history of video.
Are you a prophet?
Sorry?
Are you a prophet?
Are you a prophet?
At the prophet?
I don't know. I don't know. Prophet. Ah, non. Mais qu'est-ce que vous voulez dire? Si je suis prophète, prophète de quoi? De quoi? De quoi? Oui, mais de quoi? Mais de quoi? Ah, prophétie. Ah, prophet. It's not forbidden, but anyway, prophet. I don't know. Why?
Yeah. So you hope something?
Yes, we would like, but it's not sure. In fact, this area is not complete at the moment. But if one day the collection is in one institution, it will be one. We would like one institution with pedagogical aims, objectives. So it's important. But at the moment, I don't know.
But what it is for sure is that video, it's a kind of a form of art that implies sharing most of the times. So, I mean, sharing the property, because, I mean, it circulates openly, maybe, and it can also be possessed. Sharing because, I mean, in most of the collections we have been surveying or we have been looking at, I mean, you find like several pieces in the same collections, you know, being possessed by different collectors. So how do you feel also about this idea? I mean, it runs against the idea of possessing an original object that nobody else can have or possess. I mean, but video breaks this kind of rule.
But I think of, sorry, of the collection have a part of ego. I don't know. It's difficult to find a collection that has been seen only in the kitchen of someone. No, really, I never, I don't know people that do in this sense. But I don't know what to answer. Yeah. Not really. Mm-hmm. You? Yeah. We will see.
There's another question here.
Good evening. To me, it's difficult to make a difference between the art of cinema and video art. Mm. Could you tell us something about this matter?
Yo creo que ahí tiene mucho que ver también la voluntad del artista. Y tiene que ver también los medios que utiliza. Yo creo que con pocos medios se puede hacer una pieza de videoarte excelente, pero también hay otros artistas que necesitan más medios y están más cerca del lenguaje cinematográfico, que cuenta, que tiene una cierta narrativa, y digamos, esa sería un poco la frontera. Pero yo creo que los coleccionistas no somos quienes para poder discernir si esto está más cerca del cine convencional o del cine experimental o de una pieza de vídeo. Yo creo que son los propios artistas los que de algún modo se colocan, e incluso hay otros, y hay nombres muy conocidos, que han trabajado en piezas características de videoarte de 5 minutos con su formato y demás, y luego también han hecho piezas más largas que están mucho más cerca, incluso tienen distribución como los films convencionales. Yo insisto, yo creo que es el artista el que un poco tiene que definir qué es lo que quiere decir con esas imágenes, en tanto la duración, al formato, a los medios técnicos y demás.
And it's very curious because sometimes we see a video and we ask to the gallerist, the artist has been studying architecture. Ah, yes, yes. Or he has studied cinema. Yes, so there is always something. But anyway, I think it was a moment that between the experimental cinema and the video art was a thin red line, very, very thin. It was, I have seen some experimental films and some videos that are very, but I think it was some time ago. And another thing I want to say, I don't know, I lost it, sorry.
Jean-Luc Godard used to say that video thinks cinema. Sí, el, el video sí, piensa el cine.
Sí, 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 in image. And espera, se me ha ido, sorry.
There's another question there.
Quería preguntar si alguna vez se ha planteado la figura del productor en vez del coleccionista, ¿no? Como participar en la financiación de una pieza de video antes que existe el video.
Yo no sé si les pasa a todos los coleccionistas, pero en nuestro caso, y muchos de los que conocemos, es casi una tendencia irrefrenable. Llega un momento en el que eres la última parte del circuito, del artista, el galerista, el crítico, el comisario, y eres el que acabas comprando. Y sí que es cierto que a veces echa en falta tener una relación más directa con el artista y, por lo tanto, ser más partícipe de la pieza, de la obra, de la evolución, de la génesis, incluso de la producción. Y sí, en nuestro caso sí estamos pensando en la posibilidad de sistemas de producción mixto en el cual podamos ayudar a los artistas en la producción, insisto, pero para estar más involucrados en el proceso creativo del artista, que es al fin y al cabo lo que acaba apasionando al coleccionista, no tanto de acumular, sino el poderse acercar al hecho creativo y poder disfrutar de él. Entonces, cuanto más cerca estás, mejor. Bien es cierto que aquí en España es complicado todos los temas de producción, es decir, no hay ningún tipo de... No es como el mundo anglosajón, que es bastante habitual, pero ya hay algunos intentos y nosotros también, posiblemente para el año que viene, estamos ya pensando en hacer algunas acciones de esas características.
Y bueno, un tema que tienen la coleccionados, pues ya podéis imaginar, es como otros temas en pareja, ¿no? Yo, por ejemplo, I'm sorry, I changed. I think that is to collect for a couple, as we are, have sometimes some differences, ¿no? Me personally about producing a piece, injerencia, ¿cómo se dice? I think the artist has the gallerist beside and now the collector beside, and I ask myself how he can feel free really to create with so many people beside. That is my question. And I'm not sure that is good. I'm not sure. Because some artists did that, and the collector start to speak about the project, but it's a kind of influence.
Kind of imposing.
Yes, I think so. I'm asking myself. I'm not formal to saying that.
On the other hand, someone like Han Nefkens, it's kind of a prominent supporter of productions in this form. And here we have an excellent work, which is actually the last award he gave to a young Asian artist, and it's exhibited in one of the first rooms. And he actually promotes the idea that he likes to be there on the first minute, first moment that the production is started, and then actually give or donate the result to an institution. So he's someone who's not actually holding the work, not even for a minute, he's just supporting it and then kind of passing it to an institution to be publicly accessible.
And why not to buy directly the piece of one artist? Is a way to support too. I don't know, this is a question, no?
Yeah, it is as well.
It's a way of support. Buy art. Buy art.
The answer to your question, because what you mentioned, said that, you know, why not buy the art? I was in the studio of Melanie Smith in Mexico, and to answer your question, she said, the problem that I have is that I need to find the financing myself for the production, okay? And then, you know, I package the whole thing, I make the, I'm mounting the movie and editing it and everything. Then I deliver it to the gallery, and the gallery then tries to mark it up by 100% and then tries to sell it. And if they cannot sell it, I can never recover my money. So she's, that's when, to your question, you know, why is it not better to buy it from the gallery? That's one way, but it asks questions to the artist who's got to produce most of the time by themselves. Sometimes the gallery intervenes in that level, but very often it is not the case. So it is a problem for the medium, and there should be a kind of a solution to it in some way. I prefer to buy after as well, but it's still, you know, it's still putting a lot of pressure on the medium.
I don't know. I read one article very interesting in El País, I think 1 week ago, about one artist that was very, very sick, and someone, I think, one, not one on gallerist, one, un intermediario, one...
Dealer.
Support her, so paying her medicine, doctors, and everything. And then she gave a big piece to this person, and this person cut it in many pieces, because the la venta and the
was.
Ah. Yes. Yeah.
That's not the
right So now, what I want to say, there is many, many ways to do things, and many ways to make questioning yourself about what is better to do. I don't know.
Yeah, but for sure, the roles of collector, supporter, producer is not so clear-cut, and then there is a sort of a blurry kind of possibilities.
I think there is another way to support artists. We buy videos, but we also have a foundation supporting artists, and it's quite right that the artists have a lot of problems to get their funding. The galleries are not rich, that they cannot always support. In the Netherlands, the artists go to public funds, but they cannot get full finance for the films. They have to have some private funds. It's very nice to... We also support very expensive films which we couldn't buy, but we're very happy to be involved in the process. And we do not influence the film, not at all. We just look at the quality of the project and then see what comes out of it. And sometimes we're surprised, sometimes we're a little bit disappointed, but it's very nice to do.
This is the art of supporting the work, yeah.
We have the case of one artist, we bought a piece, and then in Catalonia. And 2 years later, we came back to his studio. So he has stopped to make pieces, art pieces, and she did at that moment conciertos de lavadoras, how do you say?
Concerts with washing machines.
With washing machine, concerts with washing machines. So we have, there is many, many different situation. I think there is many ways to support.
I have another question here.
Good afternoon. I have a small question. Everyone said that there is still a lot of blurry thing. We don't know exactly. Still, artists trying to produce by themselves, and we don't know exactly who is doing what. Do you think it's due to the fact that the medium is still young, not yet mature, and there is a real need to getting more professionalized in the specific medium? There is still a lot of things to build.
I think it's just the nature of the production system that invites others to collaborate, since producing video implies also camera, sound, editing, distribution, etc., etc. So there is more chance to conceive of it as a sort of a multi-layered process or an open-ended process in which the producer should not wait to the end, or the collector does not necessarily need to wait until the end to acquire the work, and they can he or she can intervene in that process even at the start, at the onset of the whole thing. So,
just to jump into there was another question quite similar. You said that there is a lot of similarity with the cinematographic production. So, don't we have a role model here to say these guys are already quite organized? In terms of financing, producing, even distributing, even owning, you know. So then even archiving or even provide a kind of legacy. So then we have a kind of role model. Can the video art can look at this and then try to mimic? Or is it two different subject and we are far to that and it's not possible?
I would say that video art is a sort of a communist form of art because it invites the cooperation of many individuals and collectives and different forms of property, because I mean it can be shared, it can be possessed. So I mean I think it's quite an advanced form of art in that regard. And you know, I mean the possibility to intervene in the production of an image, it's something that goes as far back as to the, you know, Renaissance, when donors and patrons could actually pay in advance for a painting in exchange of being included in the picture. Maybe we should also consider the possibility of those producers, instead of being so objective, so laid back, of also becoming authors and becoming people who can actually have a say on the production. Why not?
Yo quería hacer una observación sobre los temas de distribución, que creo que eso es importante y que es lo que es uno de los factores que diferencia enormemente a este formato. Es decir, tenemos una forma de distribución equiparable al resto de las obras de arte contemporáneo, es decir, igual que la pintura, que la fotografía, a través de las galerías. Eso es lo que debe constituirlo, al menos en nuestro caso, constituye la parte fuerte de la colección. Pero no solamente eso, porque justamente el vídeo también tiene otras formas de distribución. Algunas absolutamente gratuitas, como puede ser Internet, Vimeo, otras funcionan mucho en Canadá, en Estados Unidos, que puedes hacer la descarga del vídeo a través de un streaming pagando un poquito de precio. Están las distribuidoras, aquí en España está Maca, como todos sabemos, pero está Art Intermix, en fin, muchas otras, que también es una forma de distribución de las piezas. Por lo tanto, yo creo que ninguna disciplina artística se ha visto en este momento con tanta capacidad de distribución como en este caso lo que llamaríamos vídeo. Incluso algunos formatos de obras pequeñas tienen distribución comercial en el formato de documentales o de salas comerciales. Por lo tanto, creo que se abren todos los aspectos posibles y muchos artistas se posicionan en determinadas formas de distribución totalmente distintas a las otras. Gente que nunca trabajará con la galería y viceversa.
Exacto. Yo creo que es importante pensar que el vídeo es una de esas formas que de alguna manera piensa también su distribución y su circulación, que no le es ajena a la idea de la propia obra o del propio objeto. Es un objeto para ser circulado. De hecho, yo creo que es el paradigma de la economía más avanzada. Es decir, cuando se imaginan nuevos museos, when we think of new museums, I mean, they usually represented as black boxes with figures standing there in the middle of a dark space, a bit like Bill Viola's holograms, whatever, filling the darkness of the space. So videos become somehow hegemonic in terms of imagining the new spaces, the new exhibition spaces, the new museums, the new institutions as well. Bueno, si no hay más preguntas, creo que ya hemos abusado bastante de vuestra paciencia. So thanks very much for sharing with us these thoughts. And I think we are now having a bit of a cocktail, or I don't know what exactly. Upstairs, I mean, okay. So thanks very much and see you around the fair. Bye.